You are my portion. You are my hiding place. Oh, I believe you are.
Grace and peace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ be with you all. This side of the room is far too friendly. Please settle down. We have important announcements to get through today. It is a busy week in the life of Grace Church of the Nazarene. There are a lot of things going on. We start Tuesday evening with pickleball. For those who have never played pickleball, it involves neither a pickle, well, it does involve a ball, but it's a wiffle ball. But there are no pickles. So don't be afraid of like, I don't know what I'm saying. Come on out Tuesday night. We're going to have some fun there. Wednesday, we are having a special event. We are inviting you to bring your animal friends to church on Wednesday night. We're going to have a blessing of animals. If you are not into animals, you don't like animals, you don't have pets, this may be a service for you to skip. And that is okay. But for those who do like animals, come on out. We're going to have a great time. It'll be a fun event, I think, I hope. Please do have your cats and dogs on leashes. Just have that out there. Saturday, I just found this out. So Saturday, there will be a rodeo, not here, but in our sister church up in Calvary, they're having a rodeo. There's a flyer out there, so this will be out there if you want to inform more information. Saturday's happening there. What else is going on? Momentum signups are live. Please, if you are interested in doing Momentum with our teens, we need helpers, we need adults, we need judges. If you ever really like needed to judge teenagers and make them cry, this is your opportunity. You get to sit and okay, that's enough for that. That's happening. Please, we need some help with that. Do invite your friends, not just to Momentum, but to the Blessing of the Animals. This would be a great event for people to come to. Two really important things. Just two really important things. Number one, our Encounter God weekend sign-up is live. You need to be a part of this. It is going to be a time of growing closer to Jesus and hearing from heaven. It will be a momentous event in your life and your Christian development. Sign-up sheets are out there. There's online. If you can scan your bulletin, take you there. Please take advantage of that. Finally, it's been a few months since we've done an update on our capital campaign. Right now, we're in the midst of raising money to pay down our debt. We're calling it the Building Kingdom. I've been quiet because we're getting really, really close to our goal. And I'm scared that if I say too much, people are going to take their foot off the gas. So no, thank you for those who have contributed, who have been supporting of that. If you would like information, we have some updates on it. Just know we're a hair's breadth away from getting our goal, and that's amazing. And thank you for that. I don't want to jinx it, you know, right? Okay, so we're close. We'll have a big celebration when we get there, but we got another like few months. So keep giving. Thank you. I think those are my announcements. Let us continue in worship today as we confess our faith. As soon as it comes up, there we go. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Church Universal, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. I invite the ushers to come forward as we collect our tithes and offerings today.
Church, let's pray over this offering. Lord, you are so much more faithful to us than we are of you. Just take this gift, multiply it for your glory. We love you. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Last week, we learned a new song. Scripture says to sing a new song unto the Lord. If you follow us on the socials, you've heard it. If you paid attention before the church service starts, it was on there too. If you don't know it, just move your lips like you're saying watermelon, and it'll make us look like we're worshiping together. Amen.
Amen.
What a beautiful picture of worship in heaven. And one day we'll join those angelic hosts, casting down our golden crowns upon the sea. Worship to
a thousand generations falling down in worship to sing a song of angels to the Lamb. Song of ages to the land. Your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name stands above.
a sweet spirit of worship in this place. It is so good to feel God's Spirit among us. I read an article this week, and the title was, "Is it just me or is everyone miserable?" And it did something to my soul, because I felt like, yeah, there's truth in that. There's a lot of heavy, heavy stuff that our world is carrying, that our country is carrying, that our city is carrying, that you in this place are carrying. We are invited to bring whatever that heaviness is and lay it at the feet of Jesus and find in Him comfort and relief, healing and restoration. I would invite you to join me at an altar of prayer as James is going to come and lead us today. Let us take some moments and find solace and find comfort at the feet of our Jesus, our Savior.
Let's take just a moment and just to quiet ourselves, quiet the noise around us, and meet God here. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. God, thank you for allowing us to come to your house, God, just to praise and worship you. God, you know everything going on in our lives, God. You know about the bumps and bruises, the sicknesses, the test results that we're waiting for, God. You know each and every one of those situations. God, you know all about the situations that are represented around the altar this morning. But God, as we sang this morning, God, you are above it all. And God, that's just not a song. That's a reality that we take hold of. So God, I ask that you come and you meet us here. God, that we meet you here. God, open up our hearts, open up our minds to what you have to say to us this morning. God, let us leave here different. God, let us leave here changed. God, we can't say thank you enough. But God, thank you for who you are. God, thank you for all the things that you are going to do. And God, just thank you. We love you. Amen.
Amen. And amen. Now, at this time, I usually invite those who are young in age to run away. But today is a very special day, and we are having family worship, which means you all get the privilege of staying in church. And I wrote the sermon today with you in mind. You're welcome. If you would join me in Matthew's Gospel, Matthew 21, we're going to begin reading at verse 23. Hear now the word of the Lord. When he entered the temple, the chief priests and elders of the people came to him as he was teaching, and they said, "By what authority are you doing these things, and who gave you that authority?" This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Way back in the early days of 2011, a group of people, anti-consumerist, anti-capitalist, socially concerned activists, made their way to New York City and they marched on Wall Street. They were concerned about income inequality. The rallying slogan was, "We are the 99%. And the idea was that they were gonna march and pull up and kind of gather all of the quote unquote normal people to put down the super rich. Percentages don't mean a lot to me, so I looked up the numbers just educationally for your benefit. If you make $650,000 a year, you are in the 1%. It's a little bit less if you're in Tennessee. If you make $584,000 a year, you're in the 1% in Tennessee. If you're in Mississippi, it's significantly less. Some of you live out in Mississippi, so that means you're closer to the 1%ers. That's $382,000 a year. Now, historically, societies haven't done great when a small group of people accumulate a large amount of wealth. We've always had kings and aristocrats and the bourgeoisie. I know the kids like when I mispronounce French words. That's why I did that for you guys. We've always had the haves and the have-nots, but since the Middle Ages, when that group that has a lot keeps getting more and more, things don't go so well. The Roaring Twenties crashed into the Great Depression of the 50s. Just didn't work out too well for people. Some of you have heard of the French Revolution, where a lot of one percenters got their heads cut off. Just not a great time. In 2011, you had a whole bunch of people who were angry about society's situation, only they didn't have any real power among them. They didn't have money, obviously. They didn't have political clout. They didn't have violent means at their hands. So what they did is they protested. For 59 days, they gathered in Zuccotti Park in New York City, just off Wall Street, a couple of blocks away from the stock exchange, and they had a sit-in with drum circles and chanting and lack of sanitation or showers. They protested. And after their 59 days, not really a lot changed. They kind of packed up and went home, and the world continued. This wasn't the case a few generations earlier. It was a cold February morning in 1960, and four black students from North Carolina A&T College sat down at a Woolworth counter in downtown Greensboro, North Carolina. The students' names were Joseph McNeil, Azelle Blair, Franklin McCain, and David Richmond. They purchased a few items in Woolworth's, and then they went to the whites-only counter, and they sat down. After a few moments, a waitress came by and asked them to leave, and they politely declined, and they stayed there. They weren't arrested, much to their surprise, and after a few hours, the store closed, and they went home. The following morning, about two dozen other students came with them to that same Woolworths, and they sat down at that same lunch counter. And although no major confrontation happened on that second day, the media heard about it, and they got some attention. By day three, the students got together and they formed an action committee, an executive committee. You know, college students are mean business when they start organizing committees. And throughout those sit-ins, those men and women of North Carolina A&T, they endured jeers and shouts. They had ketchup and milkshakes poured on their head. They were slapped and had every racial slur hurled at them. And every day, they got up, put on their Sunday best, and went to that counter and sat down. Eventually, he got the attention of the mayor who agreed to a quote-unquote just and honorable resolution if they would just stop showing up. But by then, the cat was out of the bag. At the end of the month, those sit-ins had taken place in more than 30 locations in seven states. And by the end of April that same year, more than 50,000 students had participated. And it was through their obstinacy, through their determination, by their bravery and their blood that things started to change. That group of people put themselves in a place that they did not belong, in a place they were not welcomed, in a place they had no power, and they claimed that place for their purposes. I tell you this story because in a lot of ways, what Jesus is doing in Matthew 21 is exactly what those students did. He is having a sit-in. He is holding a protest right in the heart of Jerusalem's temple. He didn't have a lot of money when he walked into town. He didn't have a lot of political power. He didn't have violence or the threat of violence. But what he did is he had his body and he put that body right in the middle of their power. He was a nuisance holding court in the temple. Matthew 20 has Jesus closing in on the final days of his earthly life and ministry. And as he gets near the end, he knows exactly what awaits for him in Jerusalem, and he goes there anyway. At the beginning of chapter 21, he gets on a donkey outside the city gates and he starts riding into it. And the people are caught up in the euphoria. There's shouts of Hosanna and Hallelujah. They cut down palm branches and they pave the road. They take off their coats when they run out of palm branches just so his donkey doesn't dirty its hoofs. Like a tsunami, this mass of people with euphoria and excitement, they crash into the temple. Jesus, the point of the spear. And as he walks in, He makes a mess of everything. But most of your Bibles, mine included, titles this the cleansing of the temple. And in a spiritual sense, yes, he does cleanse it, but in a very practical, on the ground level, he just makes a mess. He overturns the table. He scatters coins and money around. He knocks over the cartons with the doves. He just causes a racket and a commotion in a place that was supposed to be serene and worshipful. And then Matthew tells us that he sits down and he starts to heal. The blind and the lame, they flock to him, and he heals them of their disease, and he opens their eyes, and he sets them free. And for the next week, every day, he shows up, and he sits in the temple. Jesus is a northerner come south, and all the southerners here know how much we love that. And he sits in the temple to protest. Now, the chief priests and the elders, those were the dudes with power. Those were the landed aristocracy. Those were the ones who had the one percenters. And they don't want him there. Those were the guys that had things to do. And Jesus is sitting down in their office, and they don't like it. And so every day during that last week of his earthly life, they show up at the temple and they challenge him. Five times in a week, they challenge him. Every day, they question him. They seek to trap him. They want to arrest him, but they are afraid of the crowds. Now, the charitable reading of the chief priests and elders in this point is that they are trying to get rid of this nuisance, this problem, in a nonviolent way. That if they can just trap Jesus, if they can just win the argument, if they can just cause him to stumble, then everyone will see that he's a fraud and he can leave the temple and things can go back to the way they were. It doesn't work out that way for them. If you stay around church until late March, you'll find out what happens on Friday of that week when those chief priests and elders cave to their most violent cravings. But that's Friday. This is Monday. The day after Jesus messed up the temple, the second day of his protest. And the chief priests and the elders, they come to him with a question. And at first blush, it seems like it's a pretty innocent question. By what authority? But things are not always what they appear. It's actually two questions. They ask him, by what authority are you here teaching and healing and causing a commotion, being a nuisance? And who gave you that authority? The question assumes that there are different authorities. There are different sources of power. What is the nature of your authority, Jesus? Now, it wasn't if Jesus had authority. Clearly, this was a man who walked on earth differently than other men. Back in chapter 7, verse 29, Jesus is said to have taught with authority, not like the scribes and the Pharisees. He has power to command and control. He speaks words and demons flee. He touches people and they are healed. Jesus had authority. When he talked, people listened, and it wasn't because he had a microphone and a raised platform. He spoke, and they obeyed. But what he spoke was very, very different. Jesus said some crazy stuff during his life on earth. He taught that the first will be last. He said that you have to love your enemies. He taught that the kingdom of heaven is found in places that you would never expect among people you probably don't like. But now something's different. It's one thing for him to teach and do all of that out in the suburbs, but here he is sitting down in the court of power. Here he is in Jerusalem's temple, and he's doing all that stuff here. The chief priests don't like it. If he had stayed in the highways and the fields, he would have been okay, but right here in the middle of Wall Street, now he is not just teaching with authority. He is doing authority. He marched into the temple and overthrew their order. He started to heal people and overturned the natural hierarchies of power and privilege by healing those who were the lowest of society. Jesus came and messed up the world of the chief priests and the elders. Can I take a little tangent this morning? It's Family Sunday. And if their children like anything, it is to be play tricks on. So we're all going to Disneyland after the service. We're not. That was actually a joke from last week's sermon. It's kind of a throwback for you. If kids like a second thing, it is etymological tangents, right? I'm speaking their language. Etymology is the study of where words came from. And English is this kind of patchwork quilt of Frankenstein with all this bunch of languages from. So we have this word hierarchy behind me. This is actually a Greek word that was invented in the 5th or 6th century by a guy named Pseudo-Dionysius. That's him. Handsome devil, isn't he? Pseudo wasn't his first name, by the way. He wrote under a pen name my manuscript has nom de plume, but I thought that was a little bit too far for the kids. Okay. He invented this word hierarchy to describe the orders of angels. So if you read in the Bible, there's all these angelic creatures. And Pseudo-Dionysius kind of looked at the Bible and he said, well, I'm going to put those in order of who is higher than the S. So you have angels at the bottom level, and then you have the archangels, and you have cherubim and seraphim. You get thrones and elders and the four living creatures that surround God's throne. And as you get higher and higher on that list, you get closer and closer to God. As you get higher, as you ascend each level, you get closer to that holy darkness, that cloud of unknowing, that silent, impenetrable light that is our triune God. Now that word hierarchy that Pseudo-Dionysius invented in the 5th or 6th century, it called on. Something about how the Middle Ages ordered the world, it made sense to them. Because in their non-egalitarian society, you had that ranking. You had slaves and servants on the bottom. You had peasants and then lords and then kings. And each rung up that hierarchical ladder, you had built upon those who were beneath it. Only the thing with us humans is we take something that's good, that ascends us into God, and we who are polluted by sin, we twist it. And so instead of ascending up into the heavens, we ascend down, descend down. There are haves and have-nots. There are healthy and there are sick. There are the base level workers and then the middle managers and the C-suite folks. There is a food chain, and each link gets you higher and higher until you are at the top. From that vaunted height, you look down and you realize how precarious your position is. And when you ascend up, you realize that that hierarchy must be maintained with money, with power, and sometimes with violence. The chief priests and the elders, they come to Jesus, who has taken up his residence in their midst, right in the center of their office, and they say, "Why are you here? By what authority are you doing these things? Are you overturning our society? Are you lifting up the have-nots? Are you bringing down those with power? Why are you here? We see you have authority, but where did it come from? Is it the right kind of authority?" Authority is another Greek word in the text. It's actually exousia, and it means out of substance or being or your core. The power of choice, of liberty, of doing as one pleases, that authority comes from somewhere else. So sometimes it comes from other people. We live in a democracy, kind of. And our political leaders, they get their authority because people vote for them. King Charles gets his authority because he was born into the right family. If you're Vito Corleone, if you're Tony Soprano, you get your authority because you are willing to use violence. Not a lot of gangster people out there. Okay. Jesus' authority doesn't come from other people. Jesus' authority doesn't come from his money or his political influence. It doesn't come from his threats of violence. It doesn't come from outside. Jesus doesn't need the chief priests and the elders to support him and lift him up. In fact, Jesus refuses to even answer their question. He is the highest of all power. He is the one who sits in control. His authority is an authority that breaks down barriers and overturns the world. His authority is an upside-down authority. His authority comes from a place of pure love and holy splendor. Colossians will say it this way: He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of creation. In Him, all things hold together on earth. Everything was created by Him, all the invisible stuff and the visible stuff, whether thrones or dominions or powers or rulers. Jesus, according to Colossians, is above all things. He is in all things. In Him, the whole world holds together. He is the beginning and the firstborn of the dead. That's why Jesus stands at authority. That's why Jesus can walk into the temple and overturn the systems of power. That's why Jesus can heal the blind and release the lame. Jesus has authority. That's why Jesus has authority over you. Did you know that? No matter what you are facing, Jesus has authority. Jesus has that authority to heal and to forgive, and to redeem, and to bless. Jesus has authority to raise you up and from your addictions. Jesus has authority to restore you after that divorce. Jesus has the power to heal your illnesses and to put down disease. Jesus has the authority to release you from pain, to comfort your loneliness, to bind up the brokenhearted. Jesus has authority to calm the storms of anxiety, to put down the static of worry. Jesus has authority to raise you up from the graveyards of regret and to make you something new. It is the name of Jesus, holy and blessed, that is above every other name, so that at that beautiful name, every knee will bow and every tongue confess that our risen and reigning Redeemer is Lord of all. Jesus has authority, not just in the temple, but everywhere. Not just in the hierarchies of power and privilege, but in the world of you find yourself in, to reorder and to make something good. And so when the chief priests come to him and said, "Why are you doing this? By what authority do you think you can march into our office and make a mess?" Jesus, he ignores them, because his authority comes from himself and himself alone. But then he does something crazy. Then he does something that is unexpected and out of left field. Because Jesus takes that authority that is given to him by his power and his position as God's visible heir on earth, and he gives it to his disciples. Sometimes preachers talk about the difference between head knowledge and heart knowledge, right? You know things in your head, like eating vegetables is good for you and you need to exercise. You know that in your head, right? Shake your heads. You all know that. Some of you are, no, that's the wrong way to shake your head. But do you know it in your heart? Do you believe it? Is it here? Sometimes I think maybe we stop a little too far north. Because Jesus says that these, our hands and our feet, the things that we do, are actually how we live out our belief. In Matthew, he makes it even starker. He says that people will show up at the gates of heaven and they will claim to know him. They will have performed deeds. And he says, "I don't know you." Matthew is going to end his gospel with Jesus saying, "All authority in heaven and on earth is mine, and I give it to you so that you can go out and make disciples, so that you can go out and baptize, so that you can go out and teach." He says that his authority is given to us so that we can do things in his name. And when we do that, the power of God shows up. He also says that when we don't do the things he has told us, when we don't visit the sick and care for the poor and comfort the hurting and call on those who are in prison, when we don't live out our faith with the work of our hands and the passage of our feet, then we very well may have nothing to do with him. On this second day in Jerusalem, after being challenged by the priest and the elders, Jesus ignores their question and he tells them a parable. He says, you know, there was once a farmer who had two sons. He asked the first son to go out to work in the vineyard, and the son says, sure, Dad, I'll take care of that. But he gets to playing on his Nintendo, and time gets away, and he never goes. The father goes to the second son and says, hey, son, can you go work in the vineyard? And the second son blows up and he says, Dad, can't you see I'm busy with important work in Animal Crossing? But later, the second son kind of comes to his senses. He heads out into the field and starts pulling some weeds. Jesus ends that parable by telling the chief priest and the elders, by telling those who were high and exalted, by telling those who were spiritually with it, that the tax collectors and the prostitutes are going to get into the kingdom of God before you because they heard, they believed, and they changed. Today we are invited to the table of the Lord by the authority of Jesus, our host. He comes to us and offers to us the grace of transformation. He invites us in and washes our feet and sits us down at the place of honor, and then he serves us the greatest of all meals. For in this meal, in this tiny bit of bread, in this little cup of juice, heaven and earth meet. The eternal and divine, the holy transcendent God becomes enfleshed and present to us. In this meal, Jesus' authority comes to us and empowers us to do the work of his kingdom. Empowers us to that same upsetting and overthrowing, that same binding and loosening, that same healing and loving. This is an invitation to come and experience the grace of God, to be changed.